So we live in a world of movement and evolution, and I think not just the technology need to move. I think open mind, the knowledge and the information need to progress, that we can change many dogmas and many concepts that we have. Technology today allows that we can see different perspective of what we learned before. And this development or this integration with Sirona definitely is changing the game in occlusion. And probably we can say that the best definition for occlusion that we have is called function, because the most important events happen before the teeth get together and right after they get apart. 4 or 5 years ago, I had the beautiful opportunity to meet Christian. We have an opportunity to work in a project together in DSD Miami, and after that, we get the idea to work in a project that was DSD Function. And DSD Function was just to put that little piece that was missing into the beautiful concept that he developed of preplanning cases. I think function is really important, but some people are still defining function just as a canine guidance or anterior guidance. And I don't even think that in function we get to those movements. And that's what we're gonna be talking today. Every human being has totally different behaviors in motion, in movements, and it became like a fingerprint for each of us. So that's why we cannot standardize some movements or concepts or behaviors of the mandible in every single patient and think that everybody's gonna be the same. First of all, before I go any further, I want to apologize respectfully, because many of the concepts that I'm gonna explain today maybe can be contradictory to some of your philosophies of occlusion. And I have too much respect for education, and I know how much you guys has been investing in time and in money and in beliefs, and I know that you guys being successful working in the way that you guys work. But the body has too many compensations. I just want to share a point of view of my research for many, many years, and in the way that has been practiced in dentistry, how after get a training in regular dentistry, as all you guys in this regular school of occlusion, I went to different philosophies of physiological occlusion to get me to the point that I create a conclusion to start a new project, what is called biofunctional dynamic occlusion. But I have a lot of respect for all you guys and for all the bigger leaders and developer of occlusion concepts into the dental industry. One of the biggest concepts and controversies that I've been talking about 4 years ago, when I started using this kind of technology, was that we don't even have a hinge axis. So that concept that tells us that you can open the pinna of the articulator and be able to create a hinge axis rotations, I found with this technology that doesn't exist. This is a real-time movement into the patient utilizing CCAD technology and CCAD function. And you can see here that this patient has an initial translation prior to making a rotation. What it put in compromise that if you open a pinion articulator like this for this patient, most of the risk is that even though the restoration is gonna be break it, or that the patient is gonna develop some level of dysfunction or compensation in some part of the business that doesn't necessarily is correct. And I know that it's difficult to visualize it in that video. Maybe that was quite fast, but I'm gonna go over the pictures that we took of the video so you can have a better idea and you can make your own judgment if it's really an initial rotation or a translation. And the point that I'm developing is that it's not every patient is totally different. So in here, let's come back to the beginning and look at that condyle, and look at that condyle immediately goes out of that socket. Because that is has to be with development and growing of the patient, the classification in the way that they grow. Look at how that condyle continue going forward without to start any translation. Just as at this point, we're gonna have an initial rotation of that condyle, and that is happening to a distance that is go about 30 millimeters in opening of the patient. And it's because that mandible in that particular patient has the tendency to have to go out of that socket before that transition, that rotational move start to creating the movement. is two movements that happen simultaneously, or one can be prior to the other one, depends on the patient conditions, because we have an upper synovial compartment that is going into the part that goes into the condyle and the eminence, and one part that is the inferior synovial compartment that goes between the condyle and the superior part of the disc. And those two events can happen independent of each patient. So this is how really the kinematics happen. And I have with this technology and a study that I'm doing about 182 patients that they all show similar behaviors. It's totally different, the sequence that happened, and also it happens dependent of the pathology, of the conditions of the patient, the classification of the structural factors, how behind is the mandible. Maybe those class two patient hasn't more need of that condyle to go out of that fossa faster than a regular patient. As a fact, in the 82 patients that I've been studying with this technology, I have only two class 3 patients that they have an initial pre rotation before any translation. Now, here you can see in the screen two different trajectories. One is how normally a patient open and close when the bite is not correct, and then one with a splint in place. So that means that mandibular trajectory is the one that we recreate. We want to create a clean pad of closure. Now pay attention to this case, that for the one that eventually use any kinesiographic equipment, they can see similar of these traces, but using the front part without able to see anything or happening to the posterior wall. So now look at how medial displacement of that disc. Now how complex is this movement into this patient, how difficult is to determine where to treat that patient and what is the relationship that we have to do in this case. With this technology, we're capable to stop the cursor in any position that will facilitate that we can see exactly what is the right place to set that bite, independent of the philosophy of occlusion that you believe. If you believe in kinematics, you understand that you need to look for clean path of closure. Those patients with these conditions, like middle displacements, is one of the more difficult patients to treat. Let me come back to that slide before, because that patient that you see that dysfunctional, that's me, and this is the appliance that I have in place. This appliance is the only possibility to me to stop that before does this get displaced into that fossa medially. So what it does is when you have this in place, my bite get stopped before the disc get displaced. And this is part of the concept of understanding of biofunctional dynamic occlusion. Now, I'm really lucky to have this gentleman as a friend. I think there are some fathers for me. This is the Professor Mariano Rocabaro, who I've been doing research for over 9 years. I'm lucky that he's my patient, and his wife and his family. I've been going to Chile multiple times to teach in the university school that he's the dean. I teach hands-on courses and research cases that we do with him over there, and also at my research location here. Here in Miami, where we're having this lecture. And also, this is like my other father, Peter Farrell from Manhattan. He's also my partner in education. I'm really lucky to have them in my life. And I have too much respect because they believe. And I think the best way to learn about this is to be part of the process. Dr. Mariano Rocabado, this was 9 years ago. You can see how I have my long hair back in those days. And when we start talking about some kind of development and research, he say, I need to feel it. I need to know what it's about. Can you do research on me? So I respect people that get involved themselves into the same project so they get a taste of what it's about. So this was the first study, the first paper that we wrote that was based in the relation of nalar and chief of the mandible in relation with the rotation of the second vertebra. And 9 years later, he allows me to do the same research with him by utilizing the new technology and a totally different mindset. because we learn from experience. Here, what you can see in these screens is part of my regular diagnostic into the patient when I use instrumentation, that is to understand the effect of the cervical spine and the posture in mandibular position, because it's not just the mandible what it moves. We can see in this patient, for instance, that is Dr. Rocabaro, how is the different trajectories on him. And we can see that in his case, it's a simultaneous rotation and translation every time that he's open. If you pay attention when you're gonna see the incisal edge here, we see in the condyles, but you will see how he has an abnormal range of motion with this trajectory. And now you're gonna see the correction when I put a bite registration that I took in place, utilizing the concepts of biofunctional dynamic occlusion. So now we restore trajectories. So this philosophy is based in clean trajectories on movements. Just like you guys that play golf, or for those that they play baseball, do you understand that the most important component is to have a perfect target for the point that you start your movement all the way to the final end, without something that create any deviation, any nociception, that it will vary the trajectory of movement. And with Dr. Rocabaro, one of the biggest things that I learned is the concept of the law of the 50-50. 50% of mandibular movement, 50% cervical spine, because the glenoid fossa is attached to the skull, and the skull is dictated by the cervical spine. So that mandibular movement has to do a lot with what happened with the column and the head. Also in the middle, we can see that is the airway, that factor that we as a physicians today, we consider that we have big part of the solution for these patients that they cannot breathe at night with sleep disorders. And part of what we're doing in my philosophy of occlusion is that we treat these patients cervically. In that way, we can gain some space in the posterior part of the cervical spine, and that gives us airway. The cervical spine is so important. Like if we think that the mandible and the head is an articulator, is the same equal that the table where you put that articulator. So for those of you that are prosthodontics, that knows the value that we learned in school about the occlusal plane inclination, the inclination of the eminence, and all those factors that we actually believe that we can calibrate articulators with, that if the cervical spine is not correct, all these angles will change. Because imagine what happened with the angles with the articulators that are inclined up or down. That will make totally different connections and diagnostics and movements into the cervical spine. Professor Rocabaro explained clearly the concept of posterior cranial rotations that close spaces into the cervical vertebras. And also that we can gain a space into the cervical vertebras, and what is the relation with the mandible to go forward, and how that opened those cervical spaces. That was the first inspiration for me to start making research. That was about 9 years ago. So after that, I started doing my own research, taking these x-rays in extension and flexion, and see what is the effect on mandible position. And you can see here that when the patient look up, the mandible has the tendency to distalize back. But I went further in research, and then I decide I'm gonna try to see what is the effects of the opposite, the movements into the cervical spine. So here, this is a fluoroscopy study that I did about 5 years ago, where I showed that when the patient make a maximum opening, it's a compensation of the head to go back. It's the same like when you join, oh, you don't stay still. You normally have the tendency to move your head back a little bit, and the same happens when you're talking, when you motion, the motion of your entire head is moving that posterior element that is big part of the equation. Now, when we protrude the mandible and we make this repeatable, this would help to improve the posture, and this would create a straight neck that would create an effect in that posterior bite. So that's why we can use some devices to stimulate the corrective posture into the patient. we all talk about philosophies of occlusion, and I have respect for the people that do central relation, but it's a bone reference. And based on the studies that I have over these 182 patients, I noticed that a central relation is not a functional position. You guys spend hours trying to take these records, but in reality, the patient never is there. The temporomandibular joint is a totally different joint than the other joints of the body. And that's why it's not made it to be totally loaded. If you load in all the time in your joints, it's because you have a dysfunctional clencher. We have another doctor that they restore patients in centric occlusion. That means that they don't fix in nothing. They keep in the same relationship that the patient has. And in my philosophy of biofunctional dynamic occlusion, we open to all the relationships. Any kind of bite that you think that you don't need to put a hand in your mouth to manipulate anything, that's part of biofunctional dynamic occlusion. We believe in the functionality of neuromuscular bites. We believe in the phonetic bites. We believe in the freedom of biostatics. We believe in everything else that doesn't push a mandible behind to try to create any bone reference. In biofunctional dynamic occlusion, we believe that the first important part is the stability of the craniocervical structures, because that's the table when we're going to place the skull. But we know that the one that makes the function is called muscle, so that's our second component. But also, it's really important for us to understand that the joints is the one that facilitate the movements. So, of course, it's important to keep all those structures in the right position to create the proper stability and statics. And that's when we're going to put the final occlusion. So it's a sequence of events that happen in biofunctional dynamic occlusion. All these values that we think that we can calibrate even with the newest technology, for me, that I'm a 99% digital person, doesn't have any value if you don't have the proper records, understanding the freedom of movement and physiology of the human body. That's a really important factor. Now, we don't believe in pushing joints behind, because every time that I take a CBCT, that is every single patient that I'm seeing, we've seen these kind of condyles with all these conditions. What that means that not even the right side or the left side are equal, and there's no reason to me to use that congruence of surfaces as dominating point to make a restorative treatment or to make a therapeutic solution for the patient. We know that everything is neurologically demand, and that bite is related with something that you learn. It's based in proprioception. That's the function. Now, when we go back to the different cultures that they create the formation of the bones, we know that the bones has the potential to deformate. And that's what the same thing that can happen if you distalize a mandible. Look at this patient, for instance, how those condyles are totally different in size that shows an active reabsorption, for instance. How are you going to use this patient to use anatomical reference to try to stabilize any point of stability to start a case? Now, we understand also that the muscles always is the one that break the balance. So when the muscles are not happy, they create this balance and parafunction. That's the first chain of the problem. Then the cervical spine is going to have the tendency to create compensations. And that's why the patients start having head forward posture or tilting the head or creating any kind of parafunction into the cervical spine to compensate the forces of those muscles that they function like a rein of a horse. Now, those joints, after these forces, start remodeling and then changing in anatomy. And that's why after, the final thing that happens is that the teeth start breaking and wearing off. That's the sequence. And the important part of this is to understand how much you need to know about all these components to treat it correctly. This is more than funny. It's the reality. It's the reality to understand that the teeth are the ones that stabilize those joints. It's the reality to understand that The occlusion is an important factor that keep the muscles in balance or not. Depends how you have that occlusion, and that the body is going to be so complex that will try to stabilize the head to balance those forces. That's why your system is so forgiving, but doesn't mean that can accept it all. We have different kind of patients' adaptation. We have patients that they know that when they break in an occlusion, they have to distalize the mandible. And when they have that distalization of the mandible, it's going to be some TNJ, cervical, or muscle components that they're going to be reacting to that. We're going to get to that level of these patients that they're going to have these breakage. It's normal that we have different muscle qualities. We can have the under or overdeveloped bodies. But what is not normal is that we have some level of combination of these factors that doesn't make sense, because that means that when you're going to make the force, it's going to be a total unbalance. And conditions like that can happen in the masticatory muscles when you have the lack of occlusion or parafunction that will make one muscle develop more than the other one. So we believe in muscle homeostasis and create muscle balance. The muscle is one of the part of the body that has better adaptation. They can develop in any time, no age, no sex. Even when you break an arm, that you have a cast in your arm for 3 months, when you remove it, that arm became really skinny, but it will take you a couple more months to develop again. So all these muscle qualities doesn't have an age. So we use the muscles because it's one of the strategies to develop a better stability to treat restorative cases and dysfunctional cases. The proprioception is the key that allows and gives the information to the cortex to tell you what your bite should be. And that's what we need to have consideration. So let me try to go over a case that I did with this technology. And you can see what we can do technology these days when you have an open mind and appropriate understanding. Robert actually is one of the guys that helped me into the project with CCAT function 4 years ago. We started working. He was my trainer for Germany. And when I saw Robert, that he was 27 years old back then, one of the things that caught my attention was this level of breakage. And by golden rules, or by the anatomy of the teeth, you can tell how much wear the patient has. And in this patient, we can make a calculation that the patient has lost about 1.5 millimeters of enamel. Look at the canines, look at the centrals, look how much dental structure the patient has been missing. Now, the point is that if they lose this amount of enamel into the upper and into the bottom, we have a distalization of the mandible and a loss of vertical dimension about 3-4 millimeters. Remember, vertical dimension is not the only important factor that you lose when you have wear. You have that mandible that is losing the interdentation between the cusp fossa relationship. And the more flat this teeth became, the more potential of the mandible go behind. That's when the patient starts being more dysfunctional. In Robert, when the patient bite down, that's the habitual occlusion that you can see here in the left side, the right side, I guess. And then in the other side, you can see where the patient wants to be all the time, with the teeth apart. In a relationship that is nowhere anatomical he has. We can see the profile pictures and we can see that is the same behavior. The patient is not comfortable in the position with the teeth together as a fact. I'm sorry, I've been sick so bad since Chicago that I made 5 lectures. Now, part of the analysis that I do when the patient came to the office is to try to look for the wear facets to see how the teeth interdigitate. And to see if these wear facets make sense, if they like a match. So I ask the patient to slide down from the habitual bite to a position that shows the dysfunction, the wear. And you can see how that patient cannot tell you where is the parafunction area, where the patient is grinding. That's the first thing. The second thing that I do is I ask the patient just to hang and relax, and I open the lips with my fingers. And I want to see inside the mouth what is the relationship between the upper and the lower teeth. And that almost tells me where the patient wants to be. Then, of
61,
course,
61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67,
so of course, function tell you a lot of things. Tell you that this patient is functioning in that phonetic pattern over there. So how many of you are willing to do veneers in this case? How many of you they will lend the teeth? Yeah, it's a 50-50 chance of failure. It's a 50-50 chance of failure and 50-50 chance of inducing pathology for the patient. Why? Because even the patient break the veneers if the pattern is more dominant to be there, or the patient learn to be behind that factor and it will fight back and back and back and back. And the only way that they're gonna do that is gonna be pulling the head behind. They're gonna rotate the head, because if you guys make an exercise and put your head behind or look at the roof, you will see how your mandible distalizes. And if you look at the floor, for instance, you can see how that mandible will have the tendency to protrude. And that's the reason that we involve all these postural components into our studies. As a fact, if you have a patient or you tilt your head like this, just by gravity, your mandible is going to have the tendency to shift to this side, and you will notice that you will have premature points into this side. And that's also when we do postural equilibration into the patient, we have as a consideration all the head movements to clean the slopes in the final treatment position for our treatment or cases. We have too many variables that will change mandibular trajectories. You ever seen in your patients? You pay attention when the patient open and close, what happens? You assuming that the bite is opening in a straight line, or you are conscious that you have patients that when they open, they have these abnormal kinematic patterns that they know correct. The problem when you start seeing them is that you need to know where they're coming from. Because it's all these different alternatives where all these kinematic movements can come from. They can come for TMJ joints, because you can have one disc that is anterior or medially displayed, so because you have an inflammation into the joint in a synovitis, or you have some problems into the ligaments that is affecting that mandibular trajectory. Or you can have muscular issues into that patient that it will make it that the patient is sore, like when you go to the gym, that you work out and you can barely walk, or your walk is funny, is the same condition will happen into your muscles, into the masticatory muscles. But also, like I showed you before, when you have interference in your teeth, what happens when you try to close down and then you feel an interference in the middle that is shifting your mandible to one side? That also creates a proprioceptive pattern that is going to make that your bite is going to be different. But how about this patient that they have cervical issues, that they have the neck in a bad position, that is putting trajectories, changing the position of the glenoid fossa and the skull? How about this patient that has real facial asymmetries with the facial structures are totally different, that it will make that this patient is not going to have the condyles in the same length, or the face in some way is asymmetric? So all these factors can affect your mandibular trajectories. So in the way that we're doing it is with the integration with the Sirona technology, that we combine the intraoral scanning with the Galileus integration and with the jaw tracking that I just showed you. We integrate all these factors together to recreate the real movement into the patient. So this is Robert, and this is the initial conditions of the patient. You can see here that when the patient opened the mouth, they open in one dimension, that is going anterior. But you can see that when the patient is coming back to the occlusion, is going behind, because it's a neurological concept that is telling to him, Robert, watch out. When you're gonna close, if you close in the way that you get out, you're gonna break your teeth. And that's what happens when Robert goes to sleep in the REM sleep series, that he starts grinding his teeth because he has no control of the musculature. At that point is when the parafunctions occur. Also, it happens when the patient is in phonetic factors, that it will make that these teeth, they just create interference and they grind off. Look at what happened with Robert. Do you see that these two trajectories change? Remember that I show you that the teeth, they start grinding, getting grinded more in the anterior areas. If you can see here in the area that the teeth match in the front area, the bite is open. But also if you go and look into the condyle, you can see that that target is not all the way in the condyle sitting. Now look at what happened now when Robert put the teeth together all the way. That condyle gets seated all the way in the back. And if this fracture happened 2,000 times a day, when you're swallowing or when you're talking, you're breaking your restorations and you're creating a compensation in your system. So that's why it's important to understand dynamics. So in Robert, we make a study that involves all these postural issues that I just mentioned. All the head movements to know what is the potential of movement of the glenoid fossa into the condyle and what even was the function of central relation. Because I'm an open mind person, I do research, that makes the difference. Sometimes you want to find some things and you find different things. So I used to believe that central relation was one of the strategies to start your restorative treatments. But then when you start seeing multiple patients and you realize that, yes, it's a position that you can take. Every body can go farther back to have the bone in touch. But is that reality that the patient is going to function there? Because this temporomandibular joint is a totally different joint than the rest of the system. It's hanging like your shoulders. They have the freedom to move. It's not like the knees that is made to have all the pressure and loading of the body 24 hours a day, or let's say during the day. The mandible is totally hanging, and the only people that has the teeth and the loading, the joint loaded is the clenchers. So check out yourself in this moment and see where your teeth are. If your teeth are clean, touching at the moment, maybe you need to come back here to Miami and I'm going to be happy to treat you because you're a dysfunctional patient. Otherwise, we have something that is called freeway space, where the teeth and the mandible is hanging all the time because they need a neutral point to start the function. So when one of the philosophies that we believe, and that was part of my foundation many years ago, I studied what was called neuromuscular dentistry, that teach me the importance of the muscles. But I went further in studies, and I consider that even that is a great principle to start, has too many dogmas, that sometimes you need to have a lot of understanding of the anatomical conditions and the dynamics into the joints to allow that the machine that is creating the muscle relaxation is not overpowering the system. I have studies that I show how the patients with the sleep apnea, when you put these kind of components, the mandible will go extremely forward because the muscles lose the memory or where they need to be protected, and they overdo a movement that we're gonna put those condyles in a bad relationship. So that's what is important, to have an open mind and understand that the muscles need to be treated as muscles and joints should be treated as joints. For the transelectrical stimulation, we put electrodes that stimulate the trigeminal and the seventh cranial nerves. And they, what it does is try to create this decompression into the joints, this pulsation, that we can use it as a mechanism to get a bite registration. So basically what we can do with the new technology that we have is really see what happens when you do that. Because again, in the world of technology that we have today, guessing is totally out of the equation. If you don't measure, or you don't measure right, it's because maybe you don't have the proper tools to do it. And doesn't mean that you need to invest all this money in this technology, but at least you need to have an open mind to understand that the temporomandibular joint is different than the concepts that we learned before. And I have multiple respect for people that they did research before, but they didn't in cadavers, and the cadavers didn't cooperate too much. Now, look at how these condoms has been decompression. Look how these bands start getting loose and loose. That is the effect of transelectrical stimulation over 45 minutes. The muscles start getting relaxing and the condoms start getting more decompressed. The joints became more decompressed. But be careful with that. You always need to make an analysis of the structures before. During the process of the pulsing, you have the alternative to establish your vertical dimension wherever you want. Because the more forgiving is vertical dimension. And sadly, it's the only component that people think about. And that's why it creates that they have the capability to increase vertical dimension in articulator. What it put in a really risk the restorations and put my friends, technicians, in a really tough situation. Because they assuming the responsibility of the breakage of the restorations, understanding that the human system doesn't work as a hinge rotation. And that's a fact, not an opinion. Now, as you can see here, this is the position that I'm gonna treat Robert. How similar that looks like to the position that Robert has when he has the freedom, when I put the lips apart. So you can tell that what we capture in biofunctional dynamic occlusion is try to capture that internal expression of the human body for that internal condition and structural components that they have. Because we all unique. And the only thing that we need to try is to get an homeostatic position to start the transition of the treatment. Of course, the position that we start is not the position that we finish. We have the potential to develop a restructuration for this position. We're gonna make an splinting to the patient that of course need to be anatomical. And why need to be anatomical? Because we need to be able to create the same proprioception. Now, technology goes to the point that I get these files that you go for that machine and I can induce those files into my CAD-CAM systems. So every single movement that I record into the patient, now I'm able to put and recreate it into my CAD-CAM machine, what will allow us to pre-adjust the restorations. So we definitely reduce the chair side time. And in the way that this mechanism happened, is something that is called FGP. And it's basically multidisciplinary by registrations in motion that expose the restorations to all possible mandible movements that that human being can have. And that's the way that the system can read the mandibular movements. Now, this is the kind of appliances that I place into my patients. This is the same appliance that I show you that I wear myself. It's anatomical appliances. We don't believe in flat planes because if you go today to the symposium, to the classroom, and you found no chairs, you will never sit. Maybe it can be some inappropriate people like me that will sit in the floor or in a table or wherever it is. But most people has to recognize a chair as an element to be seated. The same happened with the human body. If you want to recognize a mandibular position, you have to put an splint that has anatomy. So the body can feel the interdigitation between the cause-fossa relationship and the patient can function correctly. So that's the principle of these anatomical appliances. Now we put it into the patient, and in the beginning, in many cases, we do this device that is an anterior ram that helps to improve the cervical posture, because when your mandible is really distalized, this creates a proprioceptive input that allows you to drive forward a little bit until you start learning that and developing muscle ingrams. That will take about 3 months of your time until you learn where it's going to be the new position. This is the day of
open big, close, open, yes, close.
So what this shows is basically that you have the potential to open and close in new positions. If the bite is correct and your relationship and your structural conditions make sense, you're gonna have the ability to recognize that bite in an easy way. Now look at what happened in the previous bite. You can see the range of motion that I showed you before. Patient goes in for one way and come for the other way. And when we put the splint, if you pay attention, you see that it's an splint into the mouth that is anatomical. You can see how that trajectory is clean. And of course, if that trajectory is clean, the trajectory inside the temporomandibular joints that with this device you're able to see it is going to be cleaner. So this is the three changes into the patient, where the patient has to be that is uncomfortable because this is the habitual occlusion. In the way the patient treat themselves with the tongue and letting the mandible decompress and be out of habitual occlusion, and the way that biofunctional dynamic occlusion develop proprioception in an anatomical spleen to restore the patient, move the teeth to that position, or rehabilitate them. In this particular case, in Robert, we want to make the study just doing a rehabilitation, actually a mock-up. I did this case like 3 years ago, so I didn't have Nemo in that time. So all the mock-ups are not as pretty, as beautiful as we can have it today, but they functional. And we made it with the integration between CCAD function and the integration between in-lab software. And as we learned for Cushman, that he's been an amazing mentor and amazing motivator that changed the entire world of planning and diagnostic in cases, the most important part is to get the proper expressions into the patient. And here, even look at the occlusion where that mandible want to be, because the patient has been in a removable split for quite time, so the patient know where they want to be. So now what we do is we get that information into the software. And we start planning the mock-up in the bottom, but also a mock-up in the top. But the beauty of this is that became pre-adjusted. So all these dynamics that I record with the other machine now is influencing my final restoration. And the benefit of that is these elements that is my bondable mock-up parts, they're gonna become pre-adjusted. So as you can see, the software made the biggest part of the job because they pre-adjust the function in the treatment position that we treat the patient. This is the mock-ups in place. And of course, the wow factor that we look in with the concept of emotional dentistry that we make just makes sense for the patient. And then they say, okay, let's go, let's do for the plan. So we have the patient with this mock-up. We patient like what is gonna be the appearance. You can see the overlapping of all the tissues that will help us to explain what is gonna be the crown lengthening, but also we understand the function. So we remove the mock-up and we leave the patient with a fixed appliance that is gonna keep the mandibular position until the patient got restored. Now, the following case that I show, and this is my daughter's teeth when she was like a year old, and the reason that I show is not for the technicians that they can see the value of these beautiful mammalons, is because I think the only time that we have a good occlusion is when we that age, because we don't have an occlusion, the teeth doesn't touch. From that point, we have the influence at the growing of development of the body that it will make those conditions to change. This is my beautiful wife, my beautiful daughter, Cataleya, my beautiful family that I'm really proud of, and the reason that I work so hard, and we all dream together, and I hope my daughter became a dentist one day. But the reason that I chose my wife is because this is the second case that maybe I'm gonna share in the next 5 minutes, It's a case that I published in a compendium magazine, and basically is 15 years of data that I have in her case in a temporomandibular joint disorder. This was the kind of kinesiography studies that I did for many years before I get into the newest technology of Sirona. And this is the occlusion that she had that maybe every person can say is a perfect class one occlusion, no problems in there. The reality is that when the patient start functioning, let me come back to this one, oops. The reality is that when the patient start doing the phonetics and the movement, every time that she makes all these phonetics, you can see the behavior of that mandible where she wants to go. And I did that video, I think about 4 or 5 years ago when I present in Rimini for the first time for the oral design meeting. And from that point, she destroyed the teeth even more. And that's part of what the study was about. This was in 2002, at the beginning of our relation. We've been together for about 17 years. And that was the first time that I get the first kinesiograph equipment. And you can see how her teeth looks beautiful in shape. A few years later, I take more pictures because some of my education things, and you can see that I start in some level of dysfunction. In 2011, I decide to do orthopedics because I went to Brazil to learn orthopedics of the maxillary, and I found that I need to know more about orthopedics than orthodontics, the importance of the epigenetic concepts and how you can have multiple techniques to treat patients. But then when I was treating her during this time, I even make a study to demonstrate that the human body doesn't behave not even close to the unarticulator. So I measure her and I measure an articulator, and you can see how artificial is the movement of the unarticulator. That's not even close to the reality of the movement of the human being. So it makes no sense to even open a bite into articulator or make any study besides to use it as a final target to determine any restorative treatment. In 2013, I take a neuromuscular bite for my wife, but also was a position that was not comfortable for her, was inducing too much anterior position, because we find out later another complication that I will show you. So that's what is important to understand the entire physiology of the human body. Over the years 2014-15, you can see how the teeth start breaking more and more, and that's when we decide it's time for treatment. In 2016, I was lecturing with the Maestro Willy Geller in Colombia, and I decide to present this case. And in order to motivate her, I made some refractory veneers to show her how can be the smile if she decides to let me treat her correctly. That was the initial proposal. Let's say that this was the more expensive mock-up I ever used in my life, because they real feldspathic ceramics that I tried just to make a commit to getting to the TMJ treatment with me and be committed. So this is the professor Mariano Rocabaro, and then we decide to use Natalia for a study that we were publishing. So we decide to make all these mandibular position, as I explained you during the lecture today, that is what we believe that influence the mandibular patterns. We even test central relation to see what was the difference between he or me doing central relation. And as a fact, we found that the concept that many people use this technique because it's 100% reproducible, the sad part that is not. It changed me to an operator because we have a synovial compartment that can be squeezed or influenced different by different vectors of different persons. So this was Natalia in the studies that we did at the beginning. The beauty about this technology is that you can make an analysis in real time. And some that what we're seeing is how the joint in the right side has limitations. In the sagittal side, you can see a trajectory that looks like clean. That's what we can see in regular kinesiographs, but the amount of inflammation that we receive for those machines are really restricted. And you really need to be an expert to be able to read all these lines. I'm an expert. I used to use it for 12 or 13 years, and I teach about it, and I still do. But I think that you have technology that you can measure more accurate. That can be what I use these days. So look at the range of motion in Natalia before the treatment. You guys noticed was 3.8 millimeters in the right condyle, 3.85. So that means that that condyle cannot translate enough. And we need to find out what the reason. In the other side, we're going to 5.9, almost 6 millimeters. So we can see that the amplitude of movement is totally different. In the finding of the research, we found that Natalia has adhesions into the joints because she has had this displacement for too many years. What it created that condyle started getting smaller and reabsorbing, and in that process, she developed some healing tissue that is called scar tissue that restricts the movement even more. So in order to do that, and with Dr. Professor Rocavaro, they got the tissue to the idea to start breaking the adhesions. So we put a pencil into the mouth, for instance, and the patient is making loading in the chin, what is making a totally different pattern of vectors to break the adhesions. Also, Dr. Rocavaro developed these helicoids.
To one side first. No, that's as far as you can go.
So they will ask, is as far as you can go? So she's restricted. Look how they move to the other side. So we use this element to create mobility of the temporomandibular joints. And we did this for 3 years.
Come back.
So different positions. And then after 2 hours, the patient was exhausted. So of course, now we need to see that the muscles need to relax. So we put gauze in the side that we want to keep that joint distracted, just as a normal physical therapy or chiropractor strategy to put two surfaces apart. And we use the transelectrical stimulation to try to relax muscles. Then we get a bite registration. So now after that influence, we can see how that joint that was restricted to 3.9 millimeters, it gains almost 3 more millimeters of movement, what gives us more freedom to start treating the patient. So we decide that the range of motion was much better into the patient now. We're still having some dyskinetic patterns, but we already have damage into the joints, but this definitely is helping to make better motion. We conclude that the reabsorption of this condyle is one of the situations that exacerbate the process and create more issues, because now we lose the volume into the condyle, what is definitely going to shift the mandible to that side, but the muscles, they don't know that, and that's why we have these kinetic patterns. Now we start with the beautiful part, the part that we all been looking for, and now she, after that we take this bite registration, we put pivots, onlays, in the two posterior lower molars, all the way into the back to preserve the bite. Now, after all this hard work, Natalia deserved to have some veneers. Look at the amount of breakage that we have at that point. Look at those internal cracks that it shows all the forces and dysfunction that she was having before. And then at this point, basing my grand maestro, my master, who teach me how to ceramic work, I decide to do in this time three platinum foil veneers, no preparation at all, his favorite technique. And that's what we start doing, and you can see that it was no prep at all, just a proper stratification to block that transition when the teeth are getting shorter. And you can see how we can have the adaptation of these veneers with non-prep. This is the final result. You can make a smile design after that you make the proper DSD analysis with three teeth. It's just a matter to understand that there is no need for symmetry, just harmony. That you can understand that the normal flow and smile need to fit your facial conditions. That's why the concept of facial driving smiles is the more beautiful concept that can be developed. That's what we appreciate too much, all the influence of Christian in all these concepts to be able to have aesthetics. Before I finish, you can see here how the patient just have occlusion in the last molars because we put some pivots. And now that after that we fit the ceramics, we're gonna fill those gaps with physiology with some onlays. And this is the next part. I'm sorry. So this is the veneers, this is the glamour chore. How sexy those veneers became. But now it's time for rational again, be rational again. Now we take a bite registration in combination with transelectrical stimulation to fill the other teeth that need to be there. And then we make mandibular rapid movements and transelectrical stimulation to get where that bite is gonna be established and set up. That's the bite registration that we get into the patient. Now we need to fill those gaps with onlays. And of course, since everything is need to be based in evidence, with that bite registration, we make instrumentation again to see what is the stability of the temporomandibular joints and what is the behavior of the movement utilizing the real patient structures. At that point, we start designing the restorations that we're gonna do with the patient. And basically what we're doing is non-prep onlay bridges that is gonna be bondable to fit the occlusion. In that way, we can make recalculation and adjustment of the occlusion to be able to use the information for the software so they be gonna became pre-adjusted. And after that, we totally sure that everything is properly adjusted, we're gonna replace these for individual units in composite or in ceramic. So this is the beauty of this. You can recreate the mandibular movements that you record into the system, into the restorations. So this is the online bridges that we're gonna cement. We put into the model. You can see how you fill the gap. And you can see here where we're making the cementation of those structures using the posterior pad to be able to have the proper occlusion for the patient. After that, we can see in the upper part the cervical structural condition before the treatment and how we influence the change of the cervical vertebras. But also, we can see that when we test the patient with the new bite, with the new bridges cemented, how those dynamics and trajectories into the temporomandibular joints, they get improved. That is a functional analysis utilizing the new advances of technology. Then we're gonna do biofunctional postural equilibration that we use transelectrical stimulation to create involuntary pulses, changing between two colors to try to make also the equilibration using head movement. So here the patient is doing a head rotation where they've been tensing, but also we can make side bending of the head so we can clean the slopes of the restoration, take into consideration the head movement and the glenoid fossa. So that means that this part also is mobile, not fits as we think. And of course, we want to end up to marks that they go the black and the red in the same point, that it shows that the occlusion is equal and that we have the proper relationship. So then we finish the case. Thank you. So thank you so much for the attention. I hope you guys get a perspective of what technology can do these days and how it's important to be teachable, keep an open mind. And I hope I have the opportunity in the future to be there and share more clinical experience and more beautiful cases. Thank you so much and finish a beautiful event with more success. Congratulations to all the organization and all the important speakers that you have. Have a wonderful day. Thank you so much for listening.